अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन, माय नेम इज़ डॉक्टर मुश्ताक हुसैन। टुडे माय टॉपिक ऑफ प्रेजेंटेशन इज यूरेटरी ट्रॉमा। फॉलोइंग विल बी आवर लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स। वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग द एनाटॉमी ऑफ यूरेटर्स, एपिडेमियोलॉजी ऑफ यूरेटरी ट्रॉमा, इट्स वेरियस मोड्स ऑफ इंजरी, इट्स क्लासिफिकेशन सिस्टम एंड डायग्नोस्टिक इवेलुएशन फॉलोड बाई द मैनेजमेंट। Ureters are the paired fibromuscular tubes that convey the ureter from the kidneys in the abdomen to the urinary bladder in the pelvis. The average length of ureter is 25 to 30 cm. Anatomically, it's divided into the three parts: abdominal ureter that extend from the renal pelvis, running in front of the transverse process of the L2 to L5 along the medial border of the psoas major up to the bifurcation of the common iliac vessels. Pelvic ureter extends from the bifurcation of common iliac vessel, running anteriorly along the internal iliac vessels up to the ischial spine, where it turns medially and ends into the posterolateral surface of urinary bladder. Intravesical or intramural is the last distal 2 to 3 cm that run intramurally in the bladder before opening into the internal ureteric opening. Radiologically, we divide the ureter into the three part: upper part that extend from the kidney to the upper border of sacroiliac joint, middle portion that runs in front of the sacroiliac joint, and lower portion that extend from the inferior border of sacroiliac joint up to the urinary bladder. Blood supply. Ureters got a segmental blood supply. Its upper part is supplied by the renal artery, followed by gonadal vessels and the ureteral branch directly from the abdominal aorta, while pelvic portion is supplied by superior and inferior vesical arteries, in female by uterine artery, and also receives some branches from the middle rectal artery. Arterial supply will course along the ureter longitudinally, creating a plexus of anastomosing vessels. Venous drainage is carried out by the vessels that corresponds to the aforementioned arteries. Although ureteric injury is relatively rare because of its small size, mobility, and it's present in the retroperitoneum, well protected by the surrounding muscles and the bones. However, overall incidence of ureteric trauma is less than 1%. Of all urological trauma, ureteral trauma constitutes about 1 to 2.5%. Iatrogenic trauma is the most common cause, approximately 80% of the cases of ureteral injury. There are various modes of injury to the ureters that include the external traumatic injury or the iatrogenic injury. Of external traumatic injury, penetrating trauma is the most common cause, especially the gunshot injuries. About 1/3 of the cases are caused by the blunt trauma, mostly in the motor vehicle accident that involve the rapid deceleration that can result in the avulsion of ureter at the uretero-pelvic junction. And is blunt trauma usually associated with the fracture of lumbar processes and the thoracolumbar spinal dislocation. External traumatic injuries are most common in the upper ureter. The other mode of injury is the iatrogenic injury that accounts for 80% cases of the ureteric injury. Overall incidence of ureteric trauma in the iatrogenic range from 0.5 to 10%. Iatrogenic injury usually involves the lower ureter, and usually it occurs in the abdominopelvic surgical procedure, of which hysterectomy is the most common, followed by colorectal surgery, pelvic procedures like ovarian tumor removal, transabdominal urethropaxy, and abdominal vascular surgery. Ureteric injury also occur in laparoscopic and robotic surgeries, and like in laparoscopic hysterectomies and other pelvic procedures. In endoscopic procedure, ureteroscopy is the most common cause of iatrogenic injury that can cause mucosal abrasion, ureter perforation or interception, and can also lead to the avulsion of ureter.
Can you go back two slides?
Yes, sir.
So, पीछे वाले, नहीं इससे पहले वाले जो थे, थोड़ा आगे, एक और. अच्छा, ब्लंट ट्रामा में जो है वो एक्सीलरेशन इंजरी के बारे में बोला गया है कि इट्स यूजुअली रिजल्ट्स इन अवल्जन एट यूरेट्रोपेल्विक जंक्शन. तो व्हाट कुड बी द पॉसिबल कॉज? सिर्फ यूरेट्रोपेल्विक जंक्शन पे ही अवल्जन क्यों होती है? व्हाई नॉट इन मिड पोर्शन ऑफ द यूरेटर? इज देयर एनी स्पेसिफिक एनाटॉमिक रीजन बिहाइंड दैट?
Thank you.
सॉरी कोई और बेहतर रेजिडेंट्स में से कोई R1 R2 Nobody? यूरिटर जो है वो फिक्स होता है या मोबाइल फ्लोटिंग होता है एनाटॉमिकली अगर देखा जाए तो जी डॉक्टर असलाम कुछ कहना चाह रहे
हैं इट्स पेरिस्टाल्टिक मूवमेंट यूरिटर की होती है इट्स नॉट ए
माइक में बोले आवाज नहीं आ रही
पेरिस्टाल्टिक मूवमेंट होती है इसकी यूरिटर की मोबाइल
गट में हमने पढ़ा था डेक्लरेशन इंजरी अगर कोई बाउल इंजरी हो तो मोस्ट कॉमन साइट कौन सी इंजरी की डेक्लरेशन इंजरी की वजह से सॉरी डीजे जंक्शन वाई
द रेस्ट ऑफ द इलियम इज मोबाइल
सो मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम व्हेन देयर इज डेक्लरेशन इंजरी द प्रिंसिपल इज सेम UPJ is kind of fixed, while the remaining part of the ureter is mobile. Declaration injury की वजह से अगर avulsion होती है, तो that same mechanism acts on this injury as well. Argument.
Mechanism of iatrogenic injury include the crushing injury, ligation, and partial or complete transection or ischemia to the ureter by ureteral stripping or electrocoagulation, or resection of a ureteral segment, or can also lead to the angulation. Aortic injury is graded into the 5 grades by the American Association of Surgery for Trauma. Grade 1 include the contusion or hematoma without devascularization. Grade 2 include the laceration causing less than 50% of transection. Grade 3 causing laceration with greater than 50% of transection but not complete. Grade 4 include complete transection with less than 2 cm of devascularization. Grade 5 include avulsion injury with greater than 2 cm of devascularization. In case of bilateral injury, we advance one grade up to the grade 3 injuries. And there is also another scale for the description of post-URS ureteric injuries known as post-ureteroscopic lien scales. Consists of 5 grades. In grade 0, there is no lien. In grade 1, there is a superficial mucosal lien or significant mucosal edema or hematoma. Grade 2 involve the submucosal lien. Grade 3 cause a perforation with less than 50% of partial transection. Grade 4 include more than 50% of transection. And grade 5 include complete transection. Sir, I have the... Sir, it's an international scale used to for the description of the post-ureteric injury. No, not in the EU guidelines. Risk factors. Half of the ureteric injuries had no identifiable risk, but there are few risk factors that increase the risk of injuries. Ureteric injury is most common in the gynecological surgeries because of close relation of ureter to the female genital tract. And also the congenital anomalies of the course of ureter can also increase the risk of ureteric injury. There are few pathological conditions that causes the ureteric displacement can lead to the increased risk of the injury, including advanced malignancy, prior surgery or irradiation, diverticulitis, previous pelvic surgery, endometriosis, and pelvic inflammatory disease. Massive intraoperative hemorrhage and coexisting bladder injuries can also increase the risk of ureteral injury. Occult ureter injury occur more often than the reported and not all injuries are diagnosed intraoperatively. Diagnosis of ureteric injury is challenging, so a heightness of suspicion should be maintained. In penetrating external trauma, the diagnosis of ureteric injury is usually made intraoperatively during the laparotomy, while in case of blunt and iatrogenic injury, its diagnosis is usually delayed. External ureter trauma usually accompanies the severe abdominal and pelvic injury. Like penetrating trauma usually associated with vascular and intestinal injuries, while blunt trauma is associated with damage to the pelvic bone and lumbosacral spine injuries. Hematuria is usually an unreliable finding because it's present in less than one half of the patients with uretric injuries. While iatrogenic injuries may be diagnosed intraoperatively but can be usually noticed later, early recognition facilitates the immediate repair and provide better outcome. Any missed injury lead to the increased rate of complication. Intraoperatively, when there is a suspicion of uretric injury, one should have a very low threshold for complete direct ureteral inspection and various dye tests by injecting the IV indicocaramine and methylene blue can also be used to locate the uretric injury. Retrograde injection of indigo and saline can also help in the recognition of the uretric injury. Cystoscopy to look for the ureteral jet and absence of hematuria can also be used to rule out the uretric injury. Clinical signs are usually the characteristics of delayed diagnosis. Patient can present with flag pain, urinary incontinence, vaginal or drained urinary leakage, hematuria, fever, urinoma or uremia. Various radiological modalities are used in the diagnosis of ureteric injury, including CT urogram, retrograde pyelogram, antegrade uretrography, intravenous pyelography, and magnetic resonance urography. Multiphase CT is the mainstay imaging for the trauma patient. Whenever ureteral injury is suspected, CT urography with delayed images is the investigation of choice. Finding that suggests the uretric injury include contrast extravasation, delayed ipsilateral nephrogram, ipsilateral hydronephrosis, lack of contrast in distal ureter, periuretral urinoma, medial or circumrenal extravasation without distal ureter opacification that shows an avulsion injury. These are the few images of the uretric injury. There is an extravasation of contrast from interior wall of pelvis, and this is a CT scan of another image in which there is a ligation injury with concomitant bladder injury showing the obliterated lower end of the left ureter with dilated proximal segment and extravasation of contrast in the pelvic area. Then is the intravenous pyelography. Findings that suggest the uretric injury in intravenous pyelography include incomplete visualization of ureter, ureteral deviation or dilatation, urinary extravasation, hydronephrosis. One-shot IVP is unreliable in the diagnosis as it's negative in the 60% of patients. Although it's absolute nowadays used only in the resource-poor countries, its only indication is when there is an unstable patient shifted directly to the OR. When on table, one-shot IVP is used to for the assessment of the contralateral kidney.
Can you have an explanation of what is one-shot IVP? Although we don't do it more often, but we are also resource-poor countries, in one of those countries who are resource-poor. So what is this one-shot IVP? Everybody should know it, at least the formula. How much contrast should be given, and what are we looking for? Idea?
Exactly the contrast dose.
Let's involve the audience first. Many of the people want to answer that. Kamal, yes.
Sir, 2 ml per kg per body weight, but given the contrast and after 10 minutes, we will take the image. So,
and if you see if there is only one kidney, you have got the history in your hand and there it is written that the person has got only one kidney or the person is in renal failure, you reduce the dose to 1 ml per kg rather than 2 ml per kg. Right? Okay. It's very simple. But you must know all these figures, whether you are living in an era of CTKUBs and things like that.
Okay.
But it is always, it is comfortable to know all these things because you might not be able to work in a proper place in your life sometimes.
Yes.
But if you know all these tips and tricks, then you will be actually bailing out of such situations where there is nobody around you. Right?
Thank you.
And usually it's taken on table because he has already described that this is being done in patient that is vitally unstable.
In order to prevent the iatrogenic injury, one should have intimate knowledge of the location of ureter, proper visual identification of ureter, careful intraoperative dissection in the proximity of ureter, maintaining good hemostasis and with intraoperative hydration and diuresis. In case of difficult cases where there is already predictable risk of injury to the ureter, then preoperative stenting can also help in the identification of ureter intraoperatively. Ureteric injury can be followed with spontaneous resolution and healing and could lead to urinoma or urinary ascites in case of necrosis with urinary extravasation, can lead to the fistula formation leading to uretrovaginal, ureterouterine or ureterocutaneous fistula, and can also result in stenosis or stricture with insidious loss of renal function. Management. Aim of management is to reserve the renal function and also maintaining the anatomical continuity. Decision of management depends upon time of detection, nature of injury, extent of injury, site of injury, and general condition of the patient. According to the condition of patient, if a patient is stable, repair of the injured injury is usually performed at the same time as the initial laparotomy. While in case of unstable complex polytrauma patient, a damage control approach is preferred. There are four options for damage control in the ureteral injury. One is if there is a very little time and patient is unstable, one is to do nothing but plan a reoperation when the patient is more stable, usually within 24 hours. The other option is place a ureteral stent into the proximal end of the transected ureter and extrude the stent to the skin. Third, one can mobilize the ureter and extrude the ureter as cutaneous ureterostomy. Another option is to ligate the ureter and plan a staged percutaneous nephrostomy.
All these maneuvers depend upon how much time patient is giving you, because once you are going to perform an emergency laparotomy for an unstable patient, time management usually is suggested by your anesthetist colleague. So whenever you are planning to go, whenever you are called by your hospital and especially the gynecological unit, so you always have to check the vitals of the patient. If you have sufficient time to go for the repair or to go for the rescue, if you don't have time, then just put a peg, control the hemostasis, and then reopen after 24 to 48 hours and go for the care.
And these things, they look very bookish, that you ligate the ureter and leave the patient just like that. But we have already done that. I was called for an emergency case in the trauma center, and we went over there. There was a polytrauma patient and he was bleeding massively from pelvis and everywhere. And they called us that the ureter is transected and the patient's blood pressure was 60-40. So we went over there, we ligated the ureter with a non-absorbable suture, and we said we'll reevaluate it tomorrow. And if the patient is stable, we can perform a PCN. Or when you remove the pack, then we can evaluate it. Because the junior with me who was there, he said that, sir, why aren't we doing an end-to-end anastomose at that moment? So these things look bookish, but you have to do a damage control surgery. You have to save the patient's life first rather than that ureter or kidney.
One very important and very common question that you are going to be asked, and you must know about it. Whenever you are called by your gynecological or general surgical colleagues and they are suspecting any renal or ureteric injury, usually they happen to be in peritoneum, while the ureter is extraperitoneal organ. So how would you approach towards ureter? What is the landmark where you should search for the ureter? R1, R2, then R3. Summon Bukmun Umiyan.
You can ask in this way that a laparotomy is done by your colleagues and there is a midline incision, and you can find the gut and other things. They can be pushed either side, right side, left side. So you can ask your colleagues how you approach from a midline position, something which is lateral and something which is retroperitoneal.
Yes, Salimullah.
First of all, we mobilize the heart, small gut, go posteriorly and identify the inferior mesenteric artery. By identification of inferior mesenteric artery, we can palpate the aorta. And anterior to aorta, we can divide the adventitia of the aorta, and then after approach in the, superiorly to identify the renal artery. And after that,
anyone else? Yes, Osama.
To reach the retroperitoneum, we must dissect or incise the white line of TALT on the either side. And by incising white line of TALT, we would reflect the bowel towards ourselves, and then we can see the retroperitoneum. And regarding ureter, we must look for the ureter. If we are looking distally on common iliac vessels, we can identify that. And along and in the proximal, along the psoas muscle, we can identify the ureter.
So there are two approaches then. One which was actually told by Halimullah, he was not looking for the ureter. He was actually looking for something which is a central vessel, and that is aorta. So by doing so, yes, you can enter the retroperitoneal space, but then it will be very cumbersome for you to go from the midline towards lateral side. As suggested by Osama, that looks like a better approach. You don't go for a kill from an area which is already implicated. You go from a virgin area. The virgin area here is something which is on the white line, right side, left side. So you go from an area of comfort rather than from an area of difficulty.
Exactly.
And most of the times, this is being done for the renal trauma rather than a
exactly. And for that, you must be sure that you are going to get the arterial control and you are planning for the removal of the kidney. In that approach, you can cry the duodenum and directly jump over the renal vessels and renal hilum. If you want to explore and you need to see predefining, then the better approach is to go from the white line of TALT.
So the question still remains that how will you find the ureter if you cannot find the ureter?
Osama described it, but from iliac vessel you can approach the ureter.
Okay.
And go
and still you cannot find it. There is a ureter which is transected. You can find the upper part or you cannot find the upper part. You can find the lower part, you cannot find the upper part. Somebody is like me who cannot find anything. So how will you find that ureter? What are the maneuvers to find that ureter on that table? You are standing over there alone, and what does the book say about it?
Unfortunately, we just discussed that few slides.
Yeah. I'm late, I guess.
They can answer, I think. They have just read about it in the presentation.
But most of them are sleeping, I guess. Gee. Dr. Faisal.
We can do one shot IVP, and beside that, we can do integrate a pyelogram. Uretropyelogram to see whether
you are standing in a gyne OT or a civil hospital trauma center OT, and once you are standing in the gyne OT, 15 females are looking at you, sir. Mila ni mila ureter. So I don't think so. There is a fluoroscopic suit available over there. So now how will you find it?
Sir, we can give
intravenous. Listen, I'll just help you out. I'll guide you one thing, that once you're going in the exam and you're going for, don't say hi-fi things directly. Start from the basic. Understand that what the examiner is asking you, or what is the basic principle. You give something and you see urine coming out.
We can give intravenous methylene blue or indigo carmine.
लेसिक्स पहले दे दें उसको, yes. तो आपको पता चल जाएगा, यूरिन का गश आएगा. अच्छा, अब मेरा सवाल ये है कि सॉरी फॉर मेकिंग थिंग्स कॉम्प्लिकेटेड, डॉक्टर ओसामा, द पेशेंट्स बीपी इज 60-40.
द पेशेंट कांट मेक द यूरिन एंड यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू पुश नॉर्मल सेलाइन और व्हाटएवर.
सो व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू एक्सप्लेन यू इज दैट वी ऑल नो द बेसिक्स, वी नो दैट व्हाट इज गोइंग ऑन. But once you're sitting in the examiner will keep on asking you one by one every question. And for the exit exam, you have to answer these things in your uretic trauma. So you should be knowing all these.
You see, if you have attended any of the emergencies and that is necessary, then you won't forget. Since you haven't attended any emergencies, now that situation, which is on the examination room, will actually give the examiner the hint of your experience, prior experience, in just 1 second or a split second. It is very necessary for everybody, male, female, junior, colleagues, to go into emergencies whenever there is an opportunity. And there is no bigger opportunity than our unit, where every day I see your over saying that you have attended so many calls from trauma center, so many calls from, but all these calls are actually attended by senior people, which is very necessary. But they must take along all the juniors also, because totally if they don't go there, they won't see it and they won't just tell the proper answer.
In my last call, we had a call from gynecology, and one of our resident, he said that I'll go and see that call. And he went down and there was no reply from him for an hour. So I tried to contact him. We couldn't. I went down to gynae to see, and he was very comfortable. He's sitting over here. So you have to keep an eye on your junior, that what is he doing and is he in problem or not. But in the meanwhile, you should teach them as well.
And if anybody wants to sleep, please sleep when you are a little mature enough and become a professor. Don't sleep when you are a junior person, because if you sleep now, the rest of the life you will be sleeping then.
And most of the trauma surgeries you will get at night, because at that time nobody is willing to operate them, nobody is willing to see them. The seniors are sleeping and you go and see, have a look what is going on. So most of the things, what I learned was at night, that we used to go alone and see those things and learn step by step. Then we retrograde, read about it, and things go on like that.
Yeah, this is what Professor Altaf told me, that you learn surgery in odd hours when everyone else, especially your seniors, are tired and they don't want to go for the surgery. This is the time when you should jump in and perform the surgery. Secondly, they also teach us that your best book for you to train you is your patient. So whenever you go close to the patient, you see things that are most of the time not written in the book. Or even if they are written in the book, you just experience them by yourself and you are not going to forget them ever.
Sir?
Dr.
Naveed? Dr. Rafi is here. For ureter injury on table, if we found, it's depend on injury of ureters, if it's proximal or distal. We should always follow the ureter from virgin areas. If it's distal ureter, so we should follow the ureter from proximal. Or if we suspected a proximal ureteric injury, then we should follow it from distal.
Exactly, but whenever you are called in an emergency situation, there will be a lot of blood, a lot of amniotic fluid as well. So these are just landmarks where you can easily find the ureter. Then you can trace the ureter whether distally or proximally, wherever you want to trace it. So the landmark to go and for the search of the ureter is to just where it crosses the iliac vessels. Otherwise, you will be landing in no man's land.
In case of immediate diagnosis, ureter repair is done immediately. Like in ligation injury, diagnosed intraoperatively can be managed by deligation and stent placement if the ureter is viable. While in case of partial injuries, usually repaired immediately with a stent or urinary diversion via nephrostomy tube. Stenting is helpful because it provides canalization and may decrease the risk of stricture. While in case of delayed diagnosis, it is initially managed by a nephrostomy tube or a stent performed either anteriorly or retrogradely. And on follow-up, if there is any leak or any stenosis stricture, it is managed by open or robotic assisted laparoscopic surgical repair. General principle for ureteric repair include proper mobilization of the both ends of ureter, followed by debridement of any devitalized tissue and wide speculation, and tension-free watertight anastomosis over an internal stent, and external drainage is put along it. Then is the management according to this?
ये जो ना end to end anastomosis जो है वो इसमें minimum debridement करनी चाहिए. If you lose a larger length of the ureter, then it becomes difficult to have a tension free anastomosis. तो minimum debridement करनी चाहिए, और both ends should bleed when you cut the the blood tissue.
Okay.
So it's important and it should be speculated. और preferably अगर आप समझते हैं कि under tension है तो फिर mobilize करें और इसको omental wrap करें.
Omental.
It will be more. It will give the blood supply and will secure your anastomosis. Because leakage is quite common after this type of end-to-end anastomosis. Same.
Thank you.
And if you don't get that length, the ureters are not coming close by, what will you do? Any R5 sitting in the exam? Jeez, Dr. Schwab.
So we have a number of maneuvers and the procedure for the purpose. The first obviously is the mobilization. Either it is a ureter mobilization or the mobilization of the kidney. We in other words call it a renal descent as well. In some cases where we mobilize the upper mid and the lower trochee, and we can get about 6 cm length by this maneuver. By ureter mobilization, we can get about 2 cm, hardly 2 to 4 cm. And the other things we can go for are the procedures like we have are the body flap, the sausage and things like this, where we can get like 12 to 15 centimeters from the body and about 8 to 10 from the sausage, things like this. So there are a number of things we can do for this.
So sure, whenever you are answering a question, don't give numbers in absolute terms. You are giving numbers, for instance, 2 cm, 3 cm, 4 to 6 cm. And these are all relative terms. It depends upon the injury. It depends upon the anthropometric measurement of the patient. So it doesn't hold for each and every patient the same kind of length that you can have with mobilization of either the kidney or the ureter. So always give your answer in terms of something which gives you a freedom of expression as well as situation. Now, if you just confine yourself to certain numbers, then what will be the effect? The next question would eventually be that how you are sure that this kind of a length is actually be given by maneuvering. So it is not a hard and fast rule. It depends upon situation to situation and it varies.
Right.
But the thing is, the important thing is the tension-free, watertight anastomosis. No matter what you do, if you don't have this kind of a statement coming up, then everything is just on a false plane.
Okay.
That is not possible in emergency. We are talking about an emergency situation. Now, in emergency situation, if there is no possibility of something which is done in 1 or 2 minutes, then either you should just do a proper ligation of the ureter, do a proper diversion by placement of a PCN, come out, make another procedure available in times to come when the patient is stable. The patient is losing blood pressure 60-30. You can't have an intestine with the you can't have intestine with the mesentery available to you. You just wash it through and then put it like anything. So
मैं नवीन सर ये जो डैमेज कंट्रोल थी लैप्रोटॉमी और डैमेज कंट्रोल जो यूरेट्रिक इंजरीज का मैनेजमेंट था ना उसमें आपने कहा कि जी इसको स्टेंट डालें और नेफ्रोस्टॉमी करें तो प्रैक्टिकली नेफ्रोस्टॉमी करना मुश्किल होता है
एग्जैक्टली
तो इसके लिए जो है ना बेस्ट यही है कि आप सिल्क से लाइगेट करें डिस्टिलेंट और प्रॉक्सिमल में फीडिंग ट्यूब डालें और उसको एक्सटर्नलाइज करें और फिर सेकेंड लुक दे दें इसको बेस्ट जो है वो यही है क्योंकि प्रैक्टिकली आप खुद देखें कि पेशेंट अगर इंजर्ड है तो उसको नेफ्रोस्टॉमी करना मुश्किल है प्रैक्टिकली डिफिकल्ट अगर पेशेंट अनस्टेबल है डैमेज कंट्रोल यूरेट्रिक इंजरी का मैनेजमेंट है तो यूरेट्रिक स्प्लिंट वो डालें मना यूरेट्रिक फीडिंग ट्यूब
सही
और पीछे सिल्क लगाएं ताकि आपको आइडेंटिफाई कर सके व्हेन यू हैव अ सेकंड लुक
ओके Sir, is it possible that we should do a PCN later on and after a day or two when a patient is stable or not? Okay.
Depends on the patient's condition. And Say. Because the other kidney is functioning properly, in a day or two, the creatinine won't go to 20 or the patient won't go on dialysis.
Okay. Say.
urine is coming out, then you can perform it whenever it is suitable and whenever the patient is stable. Because what we discussed is that you speculated it. What was the principle that the supply should be there? उसका वैसी hypotensive supply है नहीं उसमें फिर आपने आगे कुछ कर दिया so it won't be of great use.
अच्छा अगर आपके पास DJ stand available नहीं है and you want to do an end-to-end anastomosis, then there is a historical position of a T-tube ureterostomy, right? So those were the things which you can always see in your textbook. Maybe they are not there in the newer editions, but this is something which gives you again another option of working in a situation where there is nothing available. So a surgeon is a surgeon who knows a lot of ways of just coming out of the situation. Jo aapki exit strategy hai, that has to be very much clear in your mind. You must have got three or four ways rather than one way. Because that one way which you practice day in and day out will not again be, maybe it's not available there at that moment in time. Patient is losing a lot of blood pressure and things like that.
Dr. GM, you have gone through a lot of trauma patients. What's your take on it?
A rough ride.
I was thinking that you are
trying your, to... Nah, we are not talking about your trauma. We are talking about the trauma patients.
Sir, actually, regarding ureteric injury, I have encountered only once in elective OT of Civil Hospital, Karachi, when there was a ureteric injury in a case of cancer patient. It was descending colon tumor, and during dissection, ureter was injured, and I was called over there. And I simply, when at that scenario, patient was very stable, and I simply mobilized the ureter, both hands, and end-to-end anastomosis was performed on a DJ stent. And I haven't gone through any emergency situation where ureteric injury is there, but I know as per our class teachings and seniors teaching, we have to perform the same maneuvers which we already have discussed. A lot of times we have managed bladder injuries over there in emergency, but ureteric injury experience is only one case that I mentioned. And that time patient was very stable, and end-to-end anastomosis are very approachable.
In the proximal ureteric injury, ureterostomy is usually done if the both ends of ureter can be approximated after the debridement of the debridalized tissue. In case when there is a avulsion of the ureter from the pelvis, or and there is an injury to the UPJ with pelvis is injured, ureterocolecystectomy can be an option if the patient is stable and gives time. In case of middle ureteric injury, ureterostomy is usually done, and when there is a loss of excessive segment, and transureterostomy can also be done. In this case, we mobilize the one ureter and across the midline and anastomose to the contralateral ureter. This is a real-time image of a transureterostomy done at our institute in the pediatric department.
So, what are the contraindications for transureterostomy? Zafar se pooch lete hain, Kamal.
Sir, unhealthy ureter on the other side, and that is being anastomosed on the other side, yeah. And the shorter segment, which is in which you are not able to mobilize the ureter properly.
This can't be contraindication. This is basically you cannot perform it. Is there any pre-existing conditions in which we won't go for the transureteric ureterostomy? Yes, Kamal.
Sir, Stone disease and urethroesophageal carcinoma.
Okay. And why exactly it is contraindicated or not advised to go for transureterostomy in stone disease?
Because we are converting stone-free disease, disease-free kidney to the disease one. Can we risk of the transmission?
No. Yes, the endoscopic approach to this ureter will be difficult. Like in Cohen's cross-trigonal ureteric reimplant, there is difficulty in retrograde endoscopic procedures. So same lies here as well. So if the patient has pre-existing stone disease, then we should not consider this option and rather go for the other available option.
What about
about yo-yo reflex? Have you heard about this terminology?
सन्नाटा हो गया. नाज़िश, हाउ डू यू डू दिस ट्रांसपोजिशन ऑफ यूरेटर टू द अदर साइड एनाटॉमिकली? आइदर यू आर गोइंग थ्रू द मेसेंट्री, यू आर गोइंग एक्स्ट्रा मेसेंट्रिक, रेट्रो मेसेंट्रिक, इन फ्रंट ऑफ व्हाट, बिहाइंड व्हाट?
सर, थ्रू द मेसेंट्री एंड sir, I haven't gone through the procedure for
right.
the
so anybody from this audience yes, here
yes sir we go through the mesentery of sigmoid colon we from the sigmoid colon mesentery we go behind that and we do transuratory
you want to say that you will create a window and then go and create another window and then go to the control.
You're making a lot of windows. It doesn't happen to in life.
Yes, Kamal.
Should be or it is? It should be retro. I'm not talking about peritoneum. The peritoneum is already open. I'm talking about something which is a mesentery. Mesentery is different from peritoneum. Is it? Kamal?
Sir, we should create a single window and do the anastomosis. Don't know the process.
No, no. Where this window is created? You are creating a window where? Yes, sir.
Sir, as Osama said, it's in the sigmoid colon mesentery and it's inferior to the superior to the inferior mesenteric artery.
To the inferior mesenteric artery. Right. Now here in this diagram, where is it going? Is it going in front of the aorta? Is it going behind the mesentery? Is it going through the mesentery? Because as you both are saying, you are making your ureter going through the mesentery, which is, I don't know whether it is possible or not, but it is not actually an absolute sort of a position. I think everybody should go and read it.
Read about it.
Either you have to... you have to make some arrangements so that you can be with Dr. Haris or somebody or Dr. Pardeep who are making ileal conduit and see how the ureter is moved from one end to the other side, from one side to the other side. Otherwise, you'll be messing a lot by going through the mesentery two times, not once.
Distal ureteric injury. Distal ureteric injuries are best managed by ureteric implantation because of the blood supply is usually jeopardized at the time of the ureteral injury. And in case of a larger defect and the dome of bladder can be hitched to the ipsilateral fossa that can give some additional length. And in case of a much larger defect and tubularized L-shaped flap of the bladder can be taken and ureter can be anastomosed in this flap. In case of long segment,
अच्छा इस पे थोड़ा सा मैं आपको बताऊं कि यूरेट्रिक रीइम्प्लांटेशन जब भी कर रहे हैं आप लोग तो इसको टनल ना बनाएं, ठीक है? बिकॉज इफ यू मेक अ टनल फॉर यूरेट्रिक रीइम्प्लांटेशन फॉर डिस्टल यूरेट्रिक डिस्टल यूरेट्रिक स्ट्रक्चर और इंजरी इट विल इनवेरिएबली गेट्स और मे गेट ऑब्स्ट्रक्टेड, ठीक है? तो एक तो लार्ज और स्पेचुलेटेड हो जब रीइम्प्लांट करें और टनल न बनाएं यूरेट्रिक रीइम्प्लांटेशन में. मैंने देखा है कि जब भी हमने टनल बनाया यूरेट्रिक रीइम्प्लांटेशन की बात कर तो इट गेट्स ऑब्स्ट्रक्टेड. सो इट्स आई थिंक इट्स बेटर नॉट टू मेक अ टनल फॉर यूरेट्रिक रीइम्प्लांटेशन फॉर यूरेट्रिक इंजरीज. इट्स बेटर टू हैव अ वाइड ओपन स्पेचुलेटेड एनास्मोस रादर देन हैव अ स्टेनोसिस लेटर ऑन. रिफ्लेक्स इसमें मसला नहीं है अगर डिस्टल ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन नहीं है.
In case of loss of a long segment and but these are options not really done in the emergency settings and in emergency setting we can do damage control. These are usually done and after the patient is stable we can interpose an ileal graft to bridge the defect. These are the various configuration by which the ileum can be interposed. or we can use buccal mucosal urethroplasty in case where multiple surgeries for ureteric repair has been done. And auto transplantation can also be.
Buccal mucosal urethroplasty is something new we have already discussed in our online WhatsApp forums. Dr. Osman has vast experience. I think he can.
Of two cases.
Of two cases. Osman was here earlier.
Special duty.
I think he has left. Okay. So, recently we shared a video on one of the WhatsApp groups. They were performing it laparoscopically. And we have performed two cases where you can reach Dr. Osman and he will better explain that.
In case when other options are not feasible.
Buccal mucosal graft ureteroplasty, it's the operation for ureteric strictures, long ureteric strictures, where it's anastomosis is not possible, end-to-end anastomosis is not possible. तो एक तो ये है कि उसको longitudinal incision देकर buccal mucosal graft लगाएंगे और इसको omental wrap करना चाहिए हमेशा to have a blood supply क्योंकि जो भी buccal mucosal graft लगाएंगे तो उसके लिए vascular bed जरूरी है और इस एरिया में अगर कोई नहीं है तो इसको omental wrap जरूर करें to get a good results.
Dr. Naveed, has gonadal vein been used in it? Because we have seen in strictures that a few people have used it and your online international mentor has used it as well, Fabrizio Del Moro.
Dr. Fabrizio Del Moro is an Italian surgeon. He is very good at drawings especially. And yes, he has performed a few cases. Most of them are on cadavers, I think, for learning purpose.
Animal
experiment. Animal and cadavers.
Not in humans.
Yeah, they have taken the gonadal vein. They have used the gonadal vein as a graft for the ureteric defect.
I think from the animal point of view, yes, that might be possible. But for practical purposes of many vessels available, I think the more pertinent would be to have something from the lower limb rather than from the upper. So from the abdominal side, because from the abdominal side, if you take the gonadal vein, then the gonadal vein, you have to dissect a lot. You have to go up. And if you are stuck in the pelvis, so the thing which is available percutaneously is the lower limb. It's the same as you do in bypass grafts. So you take a vascular graft from the same person. It's an autologous graft and it won't be rejected then. And it has got a more pliable sort of wall without any muscle element. And it gives you a lot of strength also as compared to gonadal. I don't know. I don't have any.
As we are already discussing graft, autologous graft, can we use the graft that are being used by our vascular colleagues in ureteric injury, any of the residents? If yes, if no, then why can't we use that? This is just a common sense question. Have you ever seen using any graft anywhere in the urinary tract? If Najam wants to answer, yes.
Urine is propulsed with the help of peristalsis. So that is, I think, one reason why I don't place grafts.
But if you're using anything else, buccal mucosa or anything, that will also not help in.
Sorry? Well, जो हम shunts वगैरह use करते हैं vascular में क्या हम वो use कर सकते हैं इसमें? Question is that. अगर नहीं तो क्यों नहीं?
For the ureters, and definitely we can use such like for SFVT purposes. We are using the GSV kits, saphenous vein, or things like this.
I think from the biocompatibility point of view, yes, we can. But from the point of view of urine sedimentation, one has to look into it because there the blood hasn't got that kind of a milieu that can lead to stone formation, for instance. But here, if you use a PTFE graft, for instance, for bridging that gap, then that graft, I don't know, maybe it reacts with the urine and the urinary sediments can give rise to stone.
It can act as a foreign body. Just we usually see incrustation of DJ stents. So same incrustation can happen with that graft as well. So this is why we usually don't use any such of stent or graft.
What I can share with you in this context is we have got one person who is still around us in this world, Anthony Atala, and he has been doing a lot of work. He is a urologist and he happens to be trained. He was trained by a Pakistani surgeon in America, and he is in Massachusetts. So his interest was in having tissue engineering. So that tissue engineering journey started from 1997, maybe 1995. And till now, he has been able to make a scaffold. And on that scaffold, he takes buccal mucosal, say, cells, scrapings. And on that scrapings and on that scaffold, he makes a sort of a parchment out of it. And since it's a mucosal parchment, then that is used for all these purposes. Since he is a urologist, he was actually confronted with these situations quite a lot in his practice. And he thought of having a biocompatible, not only biocompatible, but autologous tissue available so that we can make bladders out of it, we can make ureters out of it. So he's the one.
अच्छा ये जो डॉक्टर साहब बता रहे हैं तीनों प्रोसीजर्स जो है दे आर ऑल इलेक्टिव प्रोसीजर्स दे आर दे कैन नॉट बी डन इन अनस्टेबल एंड इमरजेंसी पेशेंट
एग्जैक्टली सर
ठीक है तो पहले उसको स्टेबलाइज करें पीसीएन से उसके बाद में ये एज ए इलेक्टिव प्रोसीजर्स
यस एग्जैक्टली दिस इज समरी ऑफ मैनेजमेंट अकॉर्डिंग टू द साइट ऑफ इंजरी एंड दिस इज एन एल्गोरिथम फॉर द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ पेशेंट A patient presenting with trauma, either blunt or penetrating, if it is he is unstable, he or she is unstable, it is directly shifted to the OR where we can do in one shot IVP. And if we got an abnormality, we suspect a risk of potential ureteric injury, we explore the ureter and repair the damage over a stent, followed by stent removal after 6 weeks. And then we follow up with the periodic LASIK rhinogram and surveillance ultrasound to look for any hydronephrosis.
I think we discussed this already. So just yes. Pass on.
Okay. Same goes with the intraoperative iatrogenic injuries and then patient with the delayed diagnosis of the ureteric injuries usually present with strictures or stenosis that are, if there is minor injury that can be managed by ureteral stent and followed by removal after 6 weeks and in case of major injuries if patient is stable and we can do the ureteric repairs as we have discussed already. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
This is just to remind that it's been a long time since we have a faculty meeting somewhere. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.